Because I've got quite a bit of ground to cover, and great to see Porrig warm the room up in terms of the gloomy factor of this. But we'll try and keep it as fresh as we can. Anyway, this is the kind of place that I show up. Now I'm going to start with a proposition, which I hope the people in the room will agree with me on. That proposition is that people can handle the truth about the environment. Like this morning. In Dublin, for example, there's a climate change conference going on in which basically the solution to everything is a bit of recycling and some green growth, okay? So there's a lot of this selling of the idea that the climate and biodiversity crises are things really that are just little minor stuff around the edges and not existential. I'm here to suggest that that is not the case at all. Now, you may or may not have seen about a month ago an extraordinary headline. Scientists discovered, this is actually more recent, in fact. This is in relation to the World Meteorological Organization earlier this week, in fact. And what they found is that we're now approaching what's called the 1.5 degree guardrail. Okay, that's the sort of outer limit for safe temperatures. Now, we were supposed to be hitting this, you know, in the mid-2030s. They're now saying there's a 50% chance that we will strike that guardrail within the next 5 years, possibly 3 years. So things are moving along much more quickly than we suspected, and unfortunately not moving in a positive direction. So climate science is complicated. It really is. However, I like to simplify things where possible. Not too much, but a little bit. Here's a much simpler way to think about climate goals, okay? So, you start out here on the outside at 0.5, 1, the 1.5 I mentioned, 2, and so on, okay? Basically, the further we go into this, the more pain we're buying into. Now, you might say, at the moment, your fingers are fine, but that's because of the part of the world that we live in. However, there's people in other parts of the world who are already experiencing the really deeply negative impacts already. So, where we choose and how much we allow climate to get away from us determines how much pain we inflict, partly on ourselves, but specifically on every generation that follows us, every generation. Now, again, I'm not going to dwell too much on the science bit, but what you're looking at here, this is a 12,000 year record of Earth temperatures since the end of the last ice age. This is a period called the Holocene. Now, you'll notice something about it. Apart from the little sticky up bit at the end, it's a remarkably stable climatic period. Now, all our agriculture, all our civilizations, all our wars, everything happened under that 1 degree guardrail. Everything happened under that 1 degree guardrail. Now, we're now at plus 1.2 degrees above pre-industrial. So we've now begun to exit that stable period, the Holocene. We're now into what's called the post-Holocene, or some people call it the Anthropocene. In other words, the age of man, of human impacts. Now, I'm going to show you three projections, which you may have seen before, but they're worth repeating here. If we're incredibly lucky, we get low climate sensitivity. Most likely, we're going to get that one in the middle, which is the 3 to 4 degree. And if we continue on our current trajectory, we get the higher one, which is in the range of 5 to 6 degrees centigrade. Now, just take a little look at this. Look at that little dotted line. Everything that our ancestors, for the last 12,000 years, the climatic conditions for life on Earth have all occurred below that dotted red line. We have no analogues anywhere in human history or experience for life beyond that red line. That's why I'm going to take a very quick 2-minute detour to explain what 4 degrees means, because people get very, very confused about temperatures. For example, 7 o'clock this morning to right now, the temperature here in Dundalk has probably increased about 4 degrees. Doesn't sound so bad. By tonight, it'll have cooled another 4 degrees. Doesn't sound so bad. And unfortunately, that's not how it works. I'm just going to show you that, if I might. Yeah. Before I do that, I've slightly reordered these. So anyway, I'll push ahead. So this was from about 6 weeks back. This is where scientists discovered that we had simultaneous Antarctic heat waves and Arctic heat waves. Antarctic regions recording 40 degrees higher than normal in March, when they should be going into winter. 40 degrees centigrade higher than normal. Simultaneously, the polar regions 30 degrees higher than normal. So this suggests major destabilization. However, this stuff isn't making the papers. This particular report that I sliced out here was from one of the UK papers. I couldn't find equivalent cuttings for Ireland for it. We're not even talking about the destabilization of the world's polar regions, because we tend to take a slightly parochial view in Ireland. Ah, the poles, the poly bears, they'll be grand. Got nothing to do with us. I'm all right, Jack. Now, that's not how it works on a small, deeply interconnected world and one extended biosphere, as our earlier speakers have described. So the kind of messaging we get instead looks something like this. You know, if we try and deal with this, they're only trying to make you poorer, right? Or, you want to fix this, what's it going to cost, right? Now, if your house is on fire, there is a cost to getting a fire extinguisher and putting the house out. But most rational people say, if your house is on fire, put out the fire, worry about what it costs later. But the way we are approaching this is, well, we'll do it as long as it's cost effective. We'll preserve life on Earth as long as we can make a buck of it. Now, again, this is so glaring obvious I shouldn't even be putting this slide up. But the bit that we obsess about, the economic domain, and indeed the place where we live, the social domain, these are wholly owned subsidiaries of the ecological domain. Yet, if you turn on the TV, read your newspapers, go online, you would think that the environment was just a place that people went to at the weekend. Or it was a story for a very, very slow news day. We have it got completely backwards. Nothing in the economic or social domain can exist unless it is within a functioning ecological domain. It's so obvious, it really screams out to say it. Now, Porrick talked about the decline of species and so on, so I'm going to dwell on that for a second. This is a slide set I've slightly modified myself, but it's from a guy called Václav Schmil. And what he did was he created a cosmic weighing scales. See that little square up the top? That's 1 million tons of mammal meat. Okay, 1 million tons. So all the humans of the world, about 7.8 billion of us, that's what we weigh in millions of tons of mammal meat. Well, give or take. Now, let's add in our pets and our livestock. Here's our cattle. Pigs. Goats. Sheep, lots of sheep, and horses, and miscellaneous human mammal support animals. So what you're looking at here is basically these are humans and human farmed animals. Now, obviously what's missing from the slide is the wild animals. So let's add them in. There we go. Now, to make that clearer, I'm going to remove the humans and our support species. Okay, so that's the situation. We punched a gigantic hole, smashed it right through the middle of the natural world, and one species among millions and its support creatures have sequestered the face of the Earth. And this has big consequences, and not just for other species. And again, back to my cosmic weighing scales. If you took all our human and domestic animals, we outweigh all wild land-based vertebrates by a factor of 42. A factor of 42. And the Washington Post described this quite well a couple of years ago. And they put it this way. They said, what we're doing to the Earth has no parallel in 66 million years. So you'll remember the 66 million years ago was when a 15-kilometer asteroid struck the Yucatan Peninsula in Mexico and wiped out all the non-avian dinosaurs and much of life besides that, and left us about 5 or 6 million years with a very quiet Earth. So we're now in the midst of what's called the sixth extinction event. We've had five, the last one 66 million years ago. We're now in a global mass extinction event. And funnily enough, we haven't really noticed, because here we are, life goes on, the lights are still on. This is a wonderful picture somebody snapped in California during one of their endless wildfire seasons. And it's called playing through. So don't have a pointer on this, but bear with me. Seeing to the left there, you've got a couple of people watching the mountain on fire, but mostly people are playing through. They adjust. We kind of go, yeah, shrug. Don't those mountains always burn? I'm pretty sure they did. They think they burned last year. Yeah, I'm pretty sure mountains always burn. This is the so-called frog in the pan syndrome. We're an amazingly adaptable species. Unfortunately, our ability to adapt to weird stuff could get a lot of us killed, because we adapt to weirdness, and very quickly we don't realize that this is deeply weird. So we don't react because we have adapted. So when I think about climate impacts, I think there's a couple of ways of thinking about them. I like to think in the Western world, we're sort of up to our knees in it at the moment. We're getting more extreme weather events, but by and large, we're still shopping. Life goes on. Those lights I mentioned, they're still on. So it's all good. In the global south, impacts, they're already up to their neck in climate impacts. And of course, it's not just climate impacts. They're also up to their neck in the detritus of overconsumption in the global north. In other words, our overconsumption. Now, okay, I got to detour back to the climate issue, because it's big. Okay, so bear with me for a moment. Okay, this is a study from 2 years ago, which again, I'm astonished how few people have been exposed to. It's quite the head turner. Okay, global warming to push billions, not millions, billions outside the climatic range that has sustained society for 6,000 years. And as the headline stated it, the climate niche that has supported humanity will shift more in the next 50 years than in the preceding 6,000 years. Now, what we're looking at here, basically, at the moment, approximately 1% of the non-ice-covered Earth surface is uninhabitable for humans because of extreme heat. That will rise by 2070 on current projections. Projections are trajectory. By 2070, to covering about 19% of the land surface of the world. Unfortunately, that is 19% where an awful lot of people live. So from left to right, we're looking at what used to be the Amazon rainforest. You're moving across North Africa, through the Middle East, across through India, Pakistan, and Southeast Asia. These are densely populated regions of the world, massive populations. Now, this, you might say, well, yeah, that's 2070, that's grand, okay? How about a couple of weeks ago? This is the 27th of April, just gone. Land surface temperatures in parts of India last month hit 62 degrees centigrade. Records fell all over the place. Pakistan experienced its hottest April in recorded history, right? This is accelerating really rapidly. 1.5 billion people live here in close to unbearable circumstances. Close to. Now, this was reported in a Bloomberg article, and they put it very interestingly. Have a read of this. It says, each summer in India is a fresh roll of the dice on whether a freak event will occur that leads to a vast number of deaths. Now, the dice that they're referring to are being loaded by the additional heating that we're pushing into the global atmosphere. The global atmosphere is a completely, for all intents and purposes, sealed system, and we're pushing heat into it at a dramatic rate. Now, I also appreciate that when I use terms like billions and blah, 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 it's kind of meaningless. So I've converted it into a little currency I call Ireland's. So this is an Ireland. That's 3 billion people, 500 times 500 times the population of this island, with nowhere to live, nowhere to go, and nothing to eat. in the lifetime of some people in this room, but certainly of our kids. And of course, the notion that you've got 3 billion, potentially, or billions of climate refugees, and somehow or other that doesn't affect us, it's beyond crazy. Even bring this forward a couple of decades. This is from the United Nations. They're projecting climate migrants to hit 1 billion by 2050. 2050 is 27 and a half years away, okay? I bet a lot of people in this room can remember 27 and a half years ago. It comes around awful fast. So here we're looking at last year. What was unusual? We had a pretty savage year last year, despite the fact that we had two global cooling events that should have, La Nina events that should have kept a lid in temperatures. Despite that, we had a really crazy summer weather. But what was unusual about it is that was happening, it wasn't just on one continent, it's like three continents simultaneously. That's what's unusual. And yes, we've always had freak weather and extreme weather. It's the frequency and the extremity that has changed, not the fact that we've always had bad weather or unusual weather, of course. So, a couple of headlines here. And these are, as you can see, from very recent, April the 4th. The UN, those extremists, warning that we're on track towards an unlivable world. Now, I'm always very wary of 3 years left to stop the worst of global warming, or we have 10 years to save the penguins, because people say, great, get back to me in 9 years and 11 months and 26 days and we'll be right onto it. Now, again, these are unbelievably serious things. Yet, here's how they actually end up getting filtered back through much of our media. Yay, hottest summer ever, okay? So that's how we're filtering so much of this stuff. And for example, one of the national newspapers the other day, when they were reporting the UN, the WMO temperatures, what did they put in the front of the paper? A big picture of a polar bear on a piece of ice. Because as you know, climate change is about polar bears and ice, and it's got nothing to do with us. And that's how so much of our media cover this. Ah yeah, bad news for the polar bears, but I don't know any polar bears. I've seen one in the Dublin Zoo, but I don't know polar bears. And to be honest with you, I don't really care, because it's not my problem, it's polar bears. So, 1976, I was 12, and there was a lovely summer heat wave in Ireland that year, okay? And this is what it looked like, okay? As you can see, there we were, nice and cozy, nice and warm, and there's a few other temperature anomalies around the world. Now, if you look at the bottom scale here, you'll see the extreme right is 5.0 degrees, okay? Now, so we had a very similar heatwave event in the June 2018. Okay, you notice the extreme right is now out to 6.2. All the heating has shifted in that period. And that's a period, that's just a, what's that, a 40-year period, there and abouts, okay? Now, scientists took the data from the June 2018 heatwave and they projected it onto mid-range RCP 6.0, mid-range heating for 2070, to have a look at how the world would look like in 2070 with a 2018 sized heatwave. And here's what they came back with. And this is why I stress that there is nowhere to hide in a globally warmed world. Our little island, our maritime position, is no protection when the fundamental conditions for life on Earth have changed beyond recognition. And just so we got this, I'm gonna go back here to 1976. 1976, okay? 2018, 2070. That's less than 100 years. So, all change. This, I should stress, by the way, is on the assumption that we just keep doing exactly what we're doing now, with a few little green initiatives around the edge to make us feel better. But this is the way we're headed. Now, as I say, some people experience these things in different ways. This is our then Taoiseach. He pointed out that warmer winters may mean less energy use and fewer deaths as a result of cold weather. And in a sense, he's not completely wrong. I'm just putting it out there. I think there's a fundamental misunderstanding about climate change in a temperate country like Ireland, where we experience warm weather as a good thing. And, you know, because temperature's up a few degrees, like this weekend, for example, it's supposed to be 20 degrees centigrade, we all go, yes, that's brilliant, because we're a fairly cold little country, so that's how we experience it. Now, that's, I suppose, that's politics for you. Now, this was a headline from a few years ago that I kept in my scrapbook from the World Bank, and they were warning about a 4-degree threshold. And what they said is the then President Jim Yong Kim described a 4-degree threshold as a doomsday scenario. That sounds a little grim. So I'm going to take about 2 minutes to show you a short graphical illustration of what a 4-degree world looks like. And I should say, by the way, you don't click your fingers and get a 4-degree world. This takes time. But what you do is you lock in the conditions where a 4-degree world becomes unavoidable. And we're at that threshold now where the decisions that we make or don't make will decide whether or not we lock ourselves onto this pathway. But I think it's really important to understand what's at stake, because I'm convinced, because of our positive messaging on climate change and our can-do problem-solving approach, that people believe that we're on top of this and we've got this one under control, and our best politicians and our brightest scientists are working out simple last-minute solutions that will turn this thing around. I'm sorry to say, so far, there is absolutely no indication whatsoever, number one, that that's happening, or number two, that our politicians, our political classes, have the faintest idea how to deal with this crisis. So, have a look, have a break.
Above 4 degrees, we're looking at a vastly different planet. Ice has vanished from both poles, rainforests have turned to desert, and rising seas reach deep into continents. Populations move to the newly thawed regions in Canada and Siberia, but even here, summers may be too hot to grow crops anywhere but the coasts. There's nothing to buy, and producers have nothing to sell. Migrants force their way into the few habitable places left on Earth. Racial conflicts and civil wars are the inevitable outcome. When temperatures were last at this level 55 million years ago, alligators lived in the Arctic, Spain was a desert, and mangroves grew in England. All of this followed a sudden burst in global warming. It may have been caused by methane hydrate, which forms under the sea and can escape with explosive force when oceans warm up. Methane is a greenhouse gas 20 times more potent than CO2. A huge eruption would make the chances of us avoiding a 5-degree rise extremely remote. To see what the world could look like at 6 degrees, we have to go back 251 million years. 95% of living species were wiped out. At sea, everything suffocated, and the only winners on land were fungi and the pig-like Lystrosaurus. Sea levels rose 20 meters, and the warmer water released pent-up methane from the seabed, with the gas shooting hundreds of meters into the atmosphere. Perhaps worse than its effect on global warming, methane is flammable. The smallest spark or lightning storm will ignite it, sending fireballs tearing across the sky. Scientists say such explosions, much greater than a nuclear bomb, could destroy life on Earth almost entirely. Hydrogen sulfide thrives in the stagnant oceans. It's devastating for marine life, and in the atmosphere it poisons trees, animals, and humans. Finally, along with massive amounts of sulfur dioxide produced in such a world, it cripples the ozone layer, exposing what life remains to fatal levels of UV radiation. The forests are burning. The rivers are drying up. Continents carved up by toxic oceans, and corpses pile up in cities across the planet. The 6-degree world is a bleak one.
So that's where we don't want to get. Yet, that's where we're headed. It's a strange reality. Unpleasant, dissonant feeling to imagine that we could be bequeathing every future generation that. Yet here we are. The commitments that we've made to cut greenhouse gases? Nope, nobody's serious about them, because we don't want to be discomforted from our, whatever it is, whether it's our foreign travel or our oversized vehicles or our whatever other comforts, because nobody thinks this is real. If we thought what we've just watched there for that 2 minutes was real, what would you do to avoid that? You would do absolutely anything. You would vote for politicians who dedicate the rest of their lives to making sure this doesn't happen. But we don't. We don't really believe it. Now, round about this time, in these type of talks, people are starting to wilt and go, I wish that guy would just go away. It's very depressing, you know. John. Why do you have to be so depressing? Can't you cheer people up? Because people need cheering up in these difficult times. I think it's important to say, particularly for among the young, that burying their heads under rocks about the climate emergency and the biodiversity emergency, this isn't making people feel better. Doing something is making people feel better. That is what I'm here to suggest. And I'll put it in simple terms. Our present course leads to certain catastrophe. So, we know where we don't want to go. Now, how do we not get there? If that isn't the most Irish way of framing a question you've ever heard. And the short answer, and deeply unsatisfactory answer, is with difficulty. So, you may have seen slides like this. I don't know if anybody knows what's going on here. Yeah, that's right. It's the manual pollination of apple trees in a province in rural China, where all the avian pollinators are no more. The so-called environmental services provided by our friends nature don't exist anymore, so we have to do it by hand. Porig already covered this, so I will get through it as fast as I can. There's a major study that was published in 2017 from 1991. Almost four-fifths of the flying insects in Germany disappeared. Now, the insect kingdom, by the way, has ruled for 400 million years. It has survived two or three mass extinction events. And it's in more trouble now than it was during the last major extinction event. And we see this again and again. Plummeting insect natures or insect numbers threaten the collapse of nature, because of course the arthropods are the tiny empires upon which all life on Earth depends. And again, as we've already discussed, it's important to say this isn't just happening somewhere else. And this headline I kept because I like it. I put it very simple. To avoid environmental catastrophe, everything must change. Not everything must change if it's economically affordable. Not everything must change if the voters will like it. Everything must change because we have no choice. That penny hasn't dropped. People haven't figured that out yet. We're in a dire existential crisis. Not a bump in the road. We're at a cliff edge for our species. Yet, you could have fooled me. The sense of eerie normality around this is shocking. This is Will Steffen from Stockholm University. Yeah, he put it very simply. He said it's difficult to overestimate the scale and speed of change. In a single lifetime, humanity has become a planetary scale geological force. And again, I'll fly through these quickly because Borg has covered them already in terms of wildlife decline, and it's happening so fast. That's the key point here. And here the projection is to hit suddenly and sooner, and scientists have identified a cliff edge, not a slippery slope. Complex systems wobble and fibrillate, but they're quite resilient, and give them half a chance, they will bounce back. Again, as Borg described, give them half a chance, they'll bounce back. But you push a complex system past a certain tipping point, and it fails. And when it fails, it stays failed for eons, far beyond the reach of human history. At the moment, we're looking at probably about 40 countries on Earth that are currently rated at being at risk of ecosystem collapse. So out of our 200 countries, round about 40 are currently ranked as being at risk of ecosystem collapse. Take a look here locally. Again, it's just while we're patting ourselves on the back about this and tutting about this awful resilience. This is the reality, and this is the marketing. Origin Green, this marketing palaver, this heavily invested. We've spent far more on promoting this than we have on either biodiversity protection or National Parks and Wildlife Service, on anything to do with actual green. This is greenwash writ large. Generously subsidized by the taxpayer, I should add. Now, we go from Origin Green to, this is Natura 2000 nodes. So, red means lower ecological integrity, green means higher. Now, if you can spot me in the Origin Green on that map, we are effectively, on this island, this green island, a dead zone, as has been already described for nature. And it is important because at the moment the deal looks something like this. It's called the paradox of progress. Nature shrinks as capital grows. The growth of the market cannot solve the crisis that it creates. So beware of people selling you green growth, that we're going to green grow our way out of brown growth. No, we're not. We're going to degrow or we're going to fail. Now, again, to give both of us a little break, I'm going to show you a short 2-minute clip of an adaptation from a BBC docudrama that was broadcast about a year ago, and it features a scientist called Dr. Phil Jones. He's a climatologist, and basically he was persecuted about 10 or 12 years ago and threatened and all the rest. And in the documentary, he's being asked to present to a House of Commons committee, but because he's a scientist, he's got great at communication. So they said, look, Phil, can you sit down and can you tell us what all your science means? So what you're going to hear is Phil Jones's words, not his voice. It's voiced by an actor, but these are his words. So it's 2 minutes, but I really think it's worth your time.
But what happens, Phil, for our children and their children? No numbers, just the consequences.
By 2100, dust bowl conditions across North America and Africa, Asia too. Sooner than that, a massive reduction in agricultural production, access to drinking water, migration in huge numbers, and bushfires on a massive scale in Australia. The West Coast, and we're melting at the poles, the West Antarctic ice sheet. Well, because of that, the global sea level rise of, well, meters.
But what does that all mean for us? People, make me see it, Phil.
Well, in this worst case scenario, 70% of the habitable world will no longer be able to sustain human life. Millions of species will become extinct. And coastal and delta cities will be underwater. And, well, if the methane in the permafrost and on the seabed is released, well...
Yes?
The climate will collapse. And the world, as we know it, will be gone.
Now we know there are some people out there who think everything you've just said is bollocks.
Never mind. You thought I was the cheerful Charlie. So, I think it's important to say, if you can keep your head while the scientific community is losing it, you may not be fully up to speed. So, Strange things are happening, by the way, not just in the scientific community, but also I've spoken recently with religious, philosophical groups and other people like that into what we would call that social domain, because this isn't a science problem, by the way. This is a human problem. This is a problem of a species that has forgotten its place in the world. So it is, to me, what we're facing here isn't really about degrees and centigrade and stuff. We have lost our place in the world, and we're in an existential crisis, and it's also a crisis of identity. We have no idea what we are. Most humans don't even realize we're animals. We're 70% nematode or earthworm or whatever, and 50% banana. We're of this world, yet we behave as if we're not. So this again is opening up some intriguing new lines in philosophical thought. And here's just some of the things that are coming out of that. I know it's slightly facetious, you don't adapt in these situations. And this does trigger some difficult feelings. I'm going to talk about those in my last few minutes. This is Dr. Christina Nicol. She's looked at this in detail. And she said, grief processed on one's own turns to despair, but grief processed communally becomes medicine. And you might say, well, grief about what? Grief about the death of the future. This is sort of ontological grief. This is the grief that is rapidly spreading from the scientific, from the activist community, and spreading out further and further through the school protesters and other people that are waking up to the death of our civilization and the death of our world. Not the absolute death of our world, probably, but in human terms, the death of our world. Sorry, let me rephrase that. The imminent death of our world. Because, and I put it in her words, the only thing that may save us may be our own broken hearts. For true action can only come through these deeper feelings. Intellectually, understanding the climate and the biodiversity emergency is very straightforward. I know lots of people who understand it very well. But letting it cross from here to here and into your viscera, to let it become part of who you are, that's really difficult, because that requires overcoming the most powerful force in human nature. And what is that? Inertia. Doing today what we did yesterday. Thinking today the way we thought yesterday. And thinking the way we were brought up. But we're in a different world, folks. We are in a different world to the world that I inherited and I walked into as a kid 50 years ago. That world is gone. It is in the rearview mirror and it's not coming back. What matters from this point forward is what options remain. None of them are great. Some of them are livable. Many of them are not. And the choices that remain are in that spectrum. They're not great choices. And another climate scientist put this really well, because a politician said this to me at a conference last Friday after I'd done my little spiel. He stood up and said, I disagree with John, why wouldn't you? What we need is more hope. And I said, look, the problem with hope is it's been distilled from a seed called hopium. And we've been dosing ourselves with hopium for the last 30 years. Right? We've had 30 years, folks, of international conferences, intergovernmental panel, 30 years. Guess what's happened to the climate system in the last 30 years? We have doubled the rate of global emissions, doubled. In the 30 years that we've been actively working this. Why? Because we're heavily dosed up to the eyeballs with hopium. Somebody will fix it. The scientists are working on it. The politicians, if it was that bad, they'd tell us. No, they bloody wouldn't. Do you know why? Because they're afraid if they told you, you'd kick them out. So they're not going to tell you. So we're all basically lying to each other, and worse than that, to ourselves. This. Now, this Gus Speth is another scientist who I've read a little bit of his work, and he said, and again, he's a physical scientist, said, I used to think the top environmental problems were biodiversity, ecosystem collapse, climate change, and 30 years of good science, we could get these. And I must say, this is how I approached it. I'm not a natural environmentalist by any means. I came to this late, and I'm a journalist by background, and I came to this mostly in shock at how little coverage it was getting in the media. So anyway, to finish Gus's point, he said he believes the top environmental problems, selfishness, greed, apathy. And only a spiritual and cultural transformation can move us forward with this. And he makes the point, that's not what scientists do. They analyze, they count the numbers. They cannot lead this. And that's why we need all of society. We need people, everyone in this room is great at something, has contacts, connections. And this is the only chance we've got in this, is ordinary people to shake ourselves up, get off our asses and say, right, we're fighting for our lives and specifically for our children's and our grandchildren's lives. This is the last chance saloon. So Clive Hamilton, he's an ethicist from Australia. He put it rather well. He said that awakening to the prospect of climate disruption compels us to abandon most of the comfortable beliefs that have sustained our sense of the world as a stable place. And when we recognize that our dreams of the future are built on sand, the natural response is to despair. The problem with despair is that tends to tune people out. And guess what? I've heard people say, oh, John, it's so bad, I've given up. You don't get off that lightly. So to finish his point, he said, in the current circumstances, clinging to hopefulness is just another form of denial. We have to allow ourselves to enter a phase of desolation and hopelessness. We have to grieve, because you can't process this until you have allowed the reality to enter your life and to realize that you're actually grieving. It's beyond that grief, and the other side of grief is the possibility for real action. At the moment, we're stuck in intellectual denial. We know it, but we haven't translated that knowing into caring. Not caring enough to change anything about how we live. Now, I'm pretty tight on time. 1 minute, well, if that's the case, I will skip the next little slide, even though it's great, you'll love this video. Anyway, it's so good. I hate that you're gonna miss this. And I'm gonna finish with this one called The Three Stages of Grief, okay? It's real simple. Despair, accept, and my favorite, act. Act like it matters.
We have had your test results. May I be blunt with you?
No.
Well, everything is fine. You're not gonna die.
Oh, that's brilliant. Thank you.
Bye.
And that's kind of where we're at. I have another wonderful video that there is such a thing as climate wrap, by the way. Now, there's one guy who does it. I met him a couple of years ago. And so I've done a tiny bit of a mashup of his song, somebody else's stolen video, and my kind of overlay. So please bear with me. I will finish with this. It's cheery.
Definition of hardcore, check out the Intergovernmental Climate Report. It says the world is getting warmer unequivocally, and the oceans have increased 30% in acidity, and 90% of the warming trend is oceanic and concentrated in the Arctic. Nobody panic, but the level of greenhouse gases in the air is higher now than it's been in millions of years. We added more than a trillion tons of CO2 to the atmosphere. It's gonna be centuries before some of the gas is clear. I'm dropping science unvarnished, unbiased, but I don't blame you if your instinct is to deny it, cause we evolved to prioritize immediate threats. If it bleeds, it leads, that's what the media says. So let the gangster-esque rap music paint a picture, and I'll hit you with some evidence-based predictions. Get ready for wars, famines, droughts, floods, hurricanes, heat waves, murders, thugs, chaos, refugees, stress, disease, extinction, disaster, IPCC. Wars, famines, droughts, floods, hurricanes, heat waves, murders, thugs, chaos, refugees, stress, disease, extinction, disaster, IPCC. Hollywood summer blockbusters can't touch this. I get my thrills from the latest reports published by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, formed in 1988 to get the science straight. Now they dropped the fifth assessment and the data's up to date, so allow me to summarize. Bad things on the way, higher emissions, sea level rise, dire predictions on target for disaster movie style predicaments. In Copenhagen we set a limit of 2 degrees, but that's still enough to disintegrate major ice sheets over the course of centuries, or maybe decades. Yeah, some of the details are still up for debate. They fluctuate between certain disaster and likely disaster, slow and steady or higher and faster. Consensus, it's the lowest common denominator, which means it's probably gonna be way worse than the wars, famines, droughts, floods, hurricanes, heat waves, murders, thugs, chaos, refugees, stress, disease, extinction, disaster, IPCC. Wars, famines, droughts, floods, hurricanes, heat waves, murders, thugs, chaos, refugees, stress, disease, extinction, disaster, IPCC. So be afraid. Very afraid, but we're not, despite what the scenarios say. And the effect of talking about it is visible yawning and occasionally changing our behavior microscopically. And even those who get it tend to get it logically but not viscerally, so we're navigating myopically. The threat is existential, it's not environmental, and your individual response is inconsequential. Only coordination of our whole species is gonna keep coastal cities from sinking below the deep seas. And when was the last time a solution included all of us? Geophysics is at the mercy of geopolitics. Climate change communicators, keep it positive. People need to feel like they still have options, and we do have options. Either we find a solution or we stick with the business as usual level pollution and get used to the wars, famines, droughts, floods, hurricanes, heat waves, murders, thugs, chaos, refugees, stress, disease, extinction, disaster, IPCC. Wars, famines, droughts, floods, hurricanes, e-waves, murders, thugs, chaos, refugees, stress, disease, extinction, disaster, IPCC.
That's it. Thanks again. Cheers.